read a couple of scriptures for you. I want you to remember them. Last week I shared a scripture. It was in Matthew chapter 9 and verse 35, one verse only. And Jesus went about all the villages, all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease amongst the people. I was glad to hear your testimony. I seen you last week up here being prayed for. You know, I was believing with you. I says, this lady's going to receive something from the Lord. And she did. Praise the Lord. The Lord healed her. Jesus Christ is here. He said, wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst. I'm right here with you. I will never leave you and I'll never forsake you. Lo, I'm with you on to the end of the world. Amen. So I have confidence to tell you today, if you come in here with cancer, you'll leave without it. Amen. I have confidence to say that because Jesus said it, not me. And he went about all the cities and all the villages. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, as many as touched him, just touched him like that. They were instantly healed. He used to spit in the dust and apply it to blind men's eyes and they began to see. He went to a wedding one day and he said, oh, we've run out of wine, what are we going to do? He gave an order, fill those pots with water. And they turned into the best burgundy wine they ever tasted in their lives. He wanted to go across the Sea of Galilee one day. He told his disciples, go on before him to the next town as he was praying with people. And finally he decided, oh, it's time I left. He didn't get in the boat. He walked across the sea. Yeah. That's the Jesus I'm talking about today. And the Bible says, blessed is the man that calls upon the name of the Lord. We've got into an awful bad habit. Instead of saying Jesus as you did last week, we're calling 911. Don't get mad at me now. You're not going to heaven to get mad at me. We've lost our confidence in the God that we serve. We're getting like Israel of old, especially our nation. We're getting like Israel of old. We don't need God anymore. We don't need this. We don't need that. We've got modern science. Why, I've got a cell phone here. Oh, this is a miracle in itself. Oh, yes. Our kids are zombies. They walk around all day. We're living in the day which is very soon going to be the mark of the beast. They're going to have a computer chip very soon, maybe this year, maybe next year, which will be implanted on your hand. You'll not need a credit card, son. You'll just go in and do that. They already have it in some states. You can go and put your hand right across the register and it'll click and tick. $50 out of your savings. These days are with us. This modern computer age is part of that system. You're soon going to be controlled. We're going to become like zombies. But the children of God that are baptized with the Holy Ghost, they're being led by the Spirit. He said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will send the Comforter. And when He has come, He will bring to your remembrance every word that I spoke. So the Holy Ghost inside you is bringing the Word of God. You were healed by faith in God. Faith comes by what? Hearing. And hearing by the Word of God. Let's look at this man, Bartimaeus, before I go into the gear two. Have you got your safety belts on? That was one scripture I give you. Here's a favorite one of mine. Reading in Luke's Gospel, chapter 4, the Bible tells us what kind of a ministry Jesus had. Like, I go to all churches. I even go to Catholic churches, believe it or not. I went to Catholic church about 10 or so years ago, and Pope Paul was the Pope at that time. And there's a big picture of the Pope with his finger pointing out towards the congregation that had said, Knights of Columbus, follow me. And I was the guest speaker. I was going to get into trouble. So I said, folks, with all respects to this gentleman at the back of me, I said, my message is, follow Christ. Amen. Don't follow a man. And he'll give you the desires of your heart. What did Jesus say? As his custom was, he went into the temple, and it was handed to him the book of Isaiah. And he opened it, and he read this here, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I wouldn't dare stand behind this pulpit without saying that. Because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, and has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those that are oppressed, that means downtrodden, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. This is the year of salvation. This is the day of salvation. This is the year of Jubilee. Then he closed the book, and he gave it back to the attendant, and sat down, and all eyes were upon him. They were fixed in him. And then he said, "This day, this scripture is fulfilled in your midst." Hallelujah. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I've seen meetings like this where the blind receive their sight, the deaf and dumb begin to speak and hear, and cripples rise out of wheelchairs and walk. I was in Belknap County Nursing Home about a month ago. I think I told you this maybe. And we were singing that little song, "I Will Enter His Gates with Thanksgiving in My Heart." Listen, when I was in the world, I could do the jazz and the jig and all the rest of it. I was always at the dance clubs and the bars and everything else. And I came into Assemblies of God Church. The pastor's name is Davy Duncan. And he was a firebrand. He was my mentor, I could say. And he would walk down, he'd run down the aisle and he'd say, "Do you people hear what I'm saying?" Oh man, when you left, you left and wow, this guy's got something from God. Jesus declared the anointing of God was upon him because this is what he sent him to do. He said, "The words that I speak are not mine, but the words of my Father." Yes, amen. We go to prayer meetings. I go to a lot of prayer meetings. And I'll hear them praying. Yes, they get down on their knees and they're serious, but they've been taught wrong doctrine. They get down and they pray this way. "Lord, send them in. Send them into our church, Lord. Send them in." Don't ask God to do your job. He told us, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It is our job to bring them in. Then they pray this way concerning healing, especially if you go to a Baptist or some other kind of church. And I go to those churches also. And they'll get down and pray this way in the prayer group. "Lord, if it be thy will." That's doubt. That's doubt. If. It's not, faith is not God can, faith is God will. Amen. Yes. Yes. And I say to them, "You folks don't say the Lord's Prayer in this church anymore." Why? "Well, it's repetitious, brother. You don't say the 23rd Psalm either." "Oh, well, that's repetitious, brother. You can't say it enough. You can't say the Lord's Prayer enough." Here's the way they pray. "If it be thy will." Here's how Jesus taught us to pray. "Father, thy will be done on earth as it is done in heaven." There are no cripples up there, no blind people up there, no cancer up there. Amen. God wants his will to be done right here in Praise Assemblies of God Church this Sunday morning. Amen. And I know Pastor Bill will say amen to that. Amen. He's going to every city, every village. Anyone that touched him was healed. He laid his hands on all people. He fed 5,000 people with a little boy's lunch. This is the Jesus I present. Not an Episcopalian Jesus that doesn't have any power. I present one that's alive and alive forevermore. I present one that rose again from the dead. Hallelujah. I present one that sits at the right hand of God. Hallelujah. Amen. A prince and a savior. I'm talking about a Christ that's coming back for the church. The greatest spectacle is not going to be the northern lights. The greatest spectacle is not be the rising of the sun in the east to the setting in the west. The greatest spectacle that will ever happen on this earth is when the heavens open up and Jesus, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, comes back. And those of us sitting in prayers, Assemblies of God, arise to meet him coming in the clouds. Hallelujah. Are you looking forward to that day?
Amen.
Amen. Preach it that way. Believe it that way. And it'll be amazing what you'll have to do. I'm going to tell you something. You can put this down in a book you want. This church is too small for what God wants to do in Tilton. Say amen. You're going to have to have a building fund to extend this building if you really trust and obey God. For he says, he'll do marvelous things in your midst. Hallelujah. The people that followed Jesus, they followed him in their thousands. When Peter was anointed by the Holy Ghost the day of Pentecost, so many people got saved. 3,000 people in one day. Within 3 days, 5,000 people. And 3,000 people, 8,000 people in a matter of 2 to 3 days. There's a man sitting at the temple gate and he says, I don't have any money, a bit like myself. He says, I don't have any money, but such as I have give I unto you. In the name of Jesus, rise and walk. Immediately stood up. 3,000 people get saved. After Peter told them, you crucified the Messiah, but he's risen again from the dead. And this man stands in your presence because of the risen Christ. I was in another church one day. I'll get to Bartimaeus eventually. I'm walking into this Pentecostal church. This was over in Ireland now. And I walked, it was a strange church, about the same size as here. But on the walls, you know what they had on the walls instead of pictures and exit signs? You know what they had on the walls? Wheelchairs. They had wheelchairs nailed to the walls. They had crutches nailed to the walls. They had all kinds of rupture belts and the kind of things, the tubes they stick in you today. They were all hanging on the walls. I thought it was in a medical professional place. I said, oh, this must be a pharmacy or something. I've missed the church. This isn't the church. And I said to somebody, tell me, what's that up in the wall for? He says, people rose out of wheelchairs and walked in the name of Jesus. And he says, that, he says, is a testimony of what Jesus Christ can do. And crutches were the same on the walls. That was their trophies. Hallelujah. Can Jesus do it and praise the assemblies of God this morning? Why, yes. Even a child knows what that is. Yes. Better put this way before I walk on it. Getting now to Bartimaeus. I'm not going to keep you too long today, but I believe miracles are going to happen here today. Our sister said that she knows there's people here going through very difficult times. I believe that you're here by purpose, by God, to be set free, to walk out of here a different man, a different woman. Bartimaeus was a blind man. By the way, I brought this here, it's not because I'm going to get into a sweat, but this was the handiest thing I had where I live. Bartimaeus was a blind man. The custom of the law was that they had to present themselves in a way that people knew they were blind. In Ireland, it's dark glasses they wear, and they have a little guide dog and sometimes a cane. Blindness is a terrible, terrible affliction. Bartimaeus was wearing something like this, only it went right down to his feet, you must say. And it told everyone in that town that he was blind. And the only way he could make a living was, according to the scriptures, to ask alms. Alms means giving a free will offering. When I was in Florida, one of the richest states in the country, just 2 weeks ago, every junction he came to, every stop sign he came to, the homeless were there and they were holding up signs and it just simply said, I'm hungry, please help me. That's pitiful to see in the United States of America. In the county I was in alone, there's over 3,000 homeless people. You don't have to suffer temperatures like this, but in the summer it goes to 120. Nowhere for them to go. Sleeping in graveyards, you name it. Help me if you can. Here's the church. We need to have the same attitude. Come here and you will be helped for sure. It was pitiful to see. Some people would stop and wind down and give them a bad, couple of curse words at them. But some people would let their windows go down and maybe put $1.50. Bartimaeus was wearing this here, told everyone he was blind, and he depended on a nickel and a dime coming from a generous person. Now, he wasn't able to see, but he's two things going for him. He had good ears, and he had a loud voice just like me. And everyone, the Bible says, it was noised abroad that the Lord was in the house. Everyone in the land had heard about this Jesus. Everyone had heard about him. The religious people didn't like him. They were the ones, by the way, that crucified him. We will not have this man to rule over us, they said. It's that way today also. It is the deeply religious people that have no time for Jesus Christ. The commandments of men have made the word of God of no effect. You don't hear that preached too often, but I'll tell it to you nevertheless. The high priest said, we will not have this man to rule over us. Pilate said, what do you want me to do with him? Crucify him, crucify him. Because they couldn't produce the miracles. They couldn't do the things that he was able to do. But Jesus Christ was able to give sight to the blind and the deaf and dumb to speak and hear and walk on water and do all these marvelous things I've told you about. They didn't like that. This was different to the custom of our country. And this poor beggar's lying there with this thing around his neck. He's been blind from birth. He's sitting in the road. He often said to himself, if only I could reach this Jesus, but I can't see. I go this way and he's going that way. And he's crying out, somebody please help me. There's not too many people willing to help you when you're blind and you don't know what's going to do. And then he heard something. Jesus of Nazareth is coming your way. Who? Jesus of Nazareth. Let's read Mark chapter 10, verse 46. Now they came to Jericho, as he went out of Jericho with his disciples, and a great multitude, that's 5,000 plus, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging, with this thing wrapped around his neck. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy upon me. The Bible says the mercy of the Lord endures forever. And many warned him, and you're going to be told, oh, this is not for today. I hate for jumping around a bit, but I was in a church one day. I was invited by four Baptist elders. Would I come to their church and preach, for they'd heard me. I used to be a speaker for the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship at one time. I used to travel this whole nation testifying for them. And I was invited to a Baptist church. I'll not mention where it is. It's not too far from here, by the way. And they had been to one of our Saturday suppers where we had a little supper and we presented the full gospel to people. And people were being baptized in the Holy Ghost and people saved and delivered and set free. And they seen this and they said, man, we need that in our church. He said, Pastor Bill, would you be willing to come to our church, the Baptist church, and preach for us? I said, sure. I'll go anywhere. I'll even go to Jewish synagogue if they let me in. So I went along, and they had a nice church, and they had the usual hymn number 255 and all the rest of it. Right, let us rise, let us sit, and all that kind of stuff. So when it came to my time, I shared my testimony. And I haven't time to share it here today, but it's quite an experience, to say the least. When you've seen the blind receive their sight, and the deaf and dumb to speak and hear, and the cripples rise and walk, you've got something to say. Yeah. And I was sharing my testimony. And I said, I went into an old Pentecostal church one day, the Assemblies of God Church in Dundonald, Northern Ireland. And I said, as the pastor said, anyone wants the baptism of the Holy Ghost, come up to the front. And I went up to the front, and they began to lay hands on me, and I began to speak in tongues as the Spirit of God gave me utterance. You don't hear that in Pentecostal churches anymore. You think we're ashamed of what we have. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ because it's the power of God unto salvation to them that believe. I go into many Pentecostal churches, not one message in tongues, not one interpretation, not one prophecy. We walk out the same way we walked in. Getting back to the Baptist church. I began to share my testimony of receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And the assistant pastor jumped to his feet and he said, we don't believe that in this church. I said, sure as I'm standing here. I looked at the elders and they were all shocked. Are they going to come and take a hold of me and throw me out or what? I didn't know. He's yelling at the top of his lungs, we don't believe that. I says, this man is speaking for all you people. He said, we. He didn't say I, he said we. I said, do you believe what he said? Yes or no? No! I said, sir, without condemning you or saying anything about you, I said, you read the Bible, and if you find one verse in the Bible that's against speaking in tongues, I said, you're right and I'm wrong. But I says, I can show you right now in black and white in the scriptures, forbid not to speak with other tongues, for he that speaks in tongues speaks not unto men, but speaks unto God. Hallelujah. I will pray in my spirit and I will pray in my understanding. I says, I can show you in black and white in scriptures. He turned around and he says, I'm out of here. I says, thank the Lord. And he left, banged the doors, he went out. It's a good example for your kids, isn't it? That's a good example to see. At the end of the meeting, they came to me, all the elders, oh, we're so sorry, what happened? That should never happen. What was in that man? I says, that was an evil spirit using him to come against God's word. I says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I said, that man didn't want you, Satan didn't want you to hear a word of faith whereby you could be delivered, set free, and saved. He hasn't changed his ways, by the way. So Bartimaeus was told to shut up. It's like many of our politicians. You may not believe this, but you know they're paid $120,000 to say nothing down in Congress. You shut your mouth and we'll give you $120,000 a year to shut your mouth. Oh, we're all for aborting all the babies. We'll kill over 3 million. Do you know we've killed over 30 million unborn Americans over the last 10 years? More than all the wars we ever fought and ever will fight. You shut your mouth and don't you say anything about that down in Congress. They call it the Supreme Court, the Supreme Devils, I call them. Shame. Shut up, Bartimaeus. Shut up. Stop making such a commotion. Hey, we don't like you praising the Lord in this church. These crazy people down lifting their hands up and waving them around. Maybe even doing a bit of a dance now and again. And that seldom happens, by the way. When I was in Pentecost, everyone danced. Hallelujah. Everyone. That's why we've got a big space here. You can dance all over the place. You know, you can do the waltz if you want. Or the old dee-da-ba-doo-doo. Shut up, Bartimaeus. Shut up. Stop making a commotion. Let me tell you something. You may say, does God really hear me? When I call upon him, does he really hear me? This poor man called. This poor man cried. And the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. Hallelujah. This is the word of God. Bartimaeus, shut up. What are you making this commotion for? Yelling at the top of your lungs. He couldn't see. My old pastor ran down the aisle and said, do you realize what I'm saying? The man couldn't see, but he could hear. What's this commotion? They were coming down the road singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, save I beseech ye. Save me, I pray of thee. That's what the word Hosanna means. People were rejoicing. People were crying out, I've received my hearing. I've just received my sight. I couldn't speak, and now I can speak. Amen. This is what was happening in every crowd where Jesus was. Bartimaeus is sitting there, alms, what's this noise coming? He couldn't see, but he could hear. What's this noise coming? Jesus of Nazareth is coming this way. Jesus of Nazareth is coming down your road. Mister, you may be here today. This could be your opportunity. Jesus of Christ is right here. You're going to walk out of this place not even saying, help me, Lord. You'd be a fool to do that. He's here. I sense his presence. I sense his anointing here. He's here to meet your need. Bartimaeus, shut up. Must have been a bit of Irish in that man. He cried all the more. Amen. He cried all the more. A beggar with no eyesight stopped God in his tracks. You think about that for a second. A beggar that just simply said, thy son of David, have mercy upon me. Stop God in his tracks. Jesus stood still. He heard that voice crying for mercy. Bartimaeus realized who Jesus was. He called him the son of David. That means he knew he was the Messiah. He knew he was the coming one. Even John the Baptist, he was going to lose his head, and he knew it. And he sent two of his disciples to Jesus, and they said to him, "Are you the coming one, or should we look for someone else?" And Jesus said to them, "Tell John this, the blind see, the deaf and dumb speak and hear, and the dead are been raised." That's all John had to hear to put his head down. He knew his ministry was over. "Shut up, Bartimaeus." "No, no, Jesus, have mercy." He stopped God in his tracks. Jesus commanded him to be called. He's wearing this thing. This thing represents that he was incapacitated. He wasn't a normal person. He couldn't see. It also speaks of sin, degradation, uncleanliness. That man, Bartimaeus, realized that he was never going to wear this thing again. You're never going to use that crutch again. You're never going to use this wheelchair again. You're never going to use this and that and the other. They may put you in high blood pressure and blow the head right off you. You're never going to have to do that again. Bartimaeus had to make a decision. Jesus stood still. He stopped God in his tracks, and Jesus says, "Bring that man to me." He knows a prayer. He knows a cry when it's made in faith, believing. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Amen. You shall be saved. Not might, or perhaps shall be. Behold, today is the day of salvation. Not yesterday or tomorrow, but today. Today is your day you're going to see. Today is your day you're going to hear. Today is the day you're going to speak. Today is the day you're going to walk out here, hallelujah, in health and strength and soundness of mind. Why? Because Jesus is here. Amen. Jesus Christ is here. I've never known him to fail. Oh, I've failed, believe you me. I'm the first one to stand up and tell you I've failed the Lord many, many times to my shame. But in my latter years, he's drawn me closer to himself. This here speaks of my shame too. It speaks of your shame. That man had this around his shoulders. It told everyone he was blind, and he stopped God in his tracks. What's the first thing he done? The Bible says he took the garment off him and he threw it in the ground. He's never going to wear it again. "My sins are gone, gone, gone." We sing those little songs when we were kids. "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They're weak, but he's strong. Bring him to me." And he brought Bartimaeus to him. Jesus asked him one question. He'll ask you one question today too. And it'll be, "Do you believe?" He says, "Bartimaeus," he says, "what do you want?" I'm sorry for picking on you. "What do you want? What do you want? What do you want, young fella? What do you want? What do you want? Ginger beard? What do you want? What do you want, Bartimaeus? What do you want, Bartimaeus? What do you want?" "Lord," he actually used the Jewish word, Rabboni. Rabboni means "my great one." He says, "my great one, that I might receive my sight." We were singing about it only about 20 minutes ago. We were singing about it. This man believed it. In his heart, his garment was lying in the dirt. And he came to Jesus and he said, "Lord, that I might receive my sight." When you come to the altar to pray, you're going to pray and ask God to do something for you. Amen. Jesus said to Bartimaeus, it says, "Your faith has made you whole." And coming to a conclusion, I could go on for another hour about this, but coming to a conclusion, Jesus said, "As you have believed, so be it." He gave him a choice again. He'll always give you a choice. "You're either going to walk with me," Jesus said, "or else you're going to go your way." He's not going to force you into the kingdom of God. He's going to invite you into the kingdom of God. He gave Bartimaeus, he gave him a choice. He received a sight instantly. Hallelujah. Then he gave him a choice. He says, "Go your way." Your faith has made you whole. And the Bible ends by saying, and he followed Jesus in his way, the road. Where did that road lead to? Who's got the best testimony, maybe, in heaven itself? Once I was blind, I sing it many times, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Once I was blind, but now I see. Bartimaeus is up in heaven, and someday I'm going to meet him face to face. Nobody's going to say to me, Bill, you never told the people half the story. He'll tell me the rest of the story. You know what the rest of the story is? He followed Jesus in the way. This was about 2 weeks before they crucified him. You call it the Lenten season over here. I might come here at Easter and sing you a song, it'll bring you to tears. It's called Watch the Lamb. You follow Jesus in the way, just like this way here. You follow Jesus, it led all the way to Jerusalem. It led all the way to Golgotha. It led all the way to Calvary's cross. And Bartimaeus could say, standing there, because he followed Jesus all the way, do you see that man that's nailed to that cross? He gave me my sight, he gave me my life, he saved my soul, body, soul, mind, and spirit. The word salvation, by the way, is to be delivered, body, soul, mind, and spirit. Your whole body. Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, which you have of God? You should be able to run, hallelujah. You should be able to walk. What's God saying in his word? He says, those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall rise up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary and walk and not faint. Do you believe it? You should be able to run like me. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I run every day. I do 6 miles every day. This is the temple of the Holy Ghost. I'm going to live for many years. Hallelujah. I'll not lose my voice. I'm going to sing and praise his name as long as I live and as long as I'm in this being. Hallelujah. Those that call upon me, Jesus said, they shall be saved. They'll never be ashamed. I'm not ashamed of this gospel. One final scripture. Look at this water. I never even used it. I have a whole message here. I never went into it, to be honest with you. I'll have to come back for a conference for it. Let me say this before I go on. This will make you laugh too. When I started going around to conferences years ago, and as a young man, I used to go to St. Louis and all these big conference halls, 1,500 people meet to hear the old Irish guy freaking out and going like a tornado. One guy came to me, the first speaker got up, I'll not mention his name, he's a well-known speaker. And he says, I'm Dr. So-and-so, and he called himself Dr. Professor something. He was the head of some Bible college somewhere, and there's nothing wrong with that, don't get me wrong. So they introduced me, and a couple of these men of high esteem in the church came up to me, and he says, what qualifications do you have? And he tried to be English people. What qualifications do you have, sir? I says, I've got qualifications. He says, what are they? I says, my real name is William in Irish, Liam McCoy. B-A-D-D. He looked at me, and he, what's he talking about? He says, what's that mean? I says, William McCoy, born again, devil disturber. And finally, before we pray, if you've got a need today, I know our time is really gone, but if you want to stay for an extra few minutes, you're more than welcome. If you have a need for prayer, if you have a need for the baptism in the Holy Ghost, if you have a need for healing or anything else, at the end of the service, this altar's open. I'll maybe sing that last song just after the scripture. Okay, Rick? In 1 Samuel 2 and verse 8, here's Bartimaeus' story, prophetically spoken of hundreds of years before Bartimaeus was even born. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust and lifts the beggar to set them amongst princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory. Bartimaeus stopped God in his tracks. He received his sight. He followed Jesus in the way for Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He witnessed the Messiah being nailed to a cross. He also witnessed him rising again from the dead. He also was one of the 120 people in the upper room that received the anointing. And he more than likely was a better evangelist than me. And he's in heaven today. And the scripture's fulfilled. He lifts the poor, the beggar, out of the dust of the ground, begging, and makes them become a prince. What has he made you? He's made you kings and priests unto him. Hallelujah. He's made you a joint heir with Christ in heavenly places. You have a very important place in God's plan. You have to win this town of Tilton. I'm not joking when I say you'll need a bigger church soon if you allow the anointing of God to come back into your life. If you'll stand up and really rejoice in the Lord and make it known that you love him. Hallelujah. If you love me, serve me, he says. Amen. Go out and do the work. I try to make this attitude. I will win a soul for Christ every day of the year. 365 people a year. I used to see 3,000 to 5,000 people saved in a year. Not boasting, but it was a reality. When God was pouring out his anointing in the early 70s, it was marvelous. I was heavily involved in the charismatic renewal movement, where great things were happening. And beloved, we haven't even begun to see what God wants to do before he comes. Amen. He's coming for his church. Get ready. You don't want to say, well, I remember a time there was 125 people used to be in church here. Where did they all go? We, our job was to get them back. Hallelujah. Like, I wasn't joking last week when I said, take them out and buy them a breakfast sandwich. And say, I'd like you to come to my church. There's good things happening in my church. You know what I want to see? What you need to see? With all respects to all these things up here, if you believe God, what I'm saying today, you'll have a drummer here. Hallelujah. I used to have a band at one time. You'll have a drummer. You'll have a bass player. Hallelujah. You'll have electric guitar players here. And you'll have people that can sing. And you'll have about half a dozen people are singing. And you'll be singing with them. And you'll have live music and live praise. This place will rock under the anointing of God. Hallelujah. There's nothing wrong with these videos. But it's not anything to be compared with the real thing. Believe me, I'm telling you the truth. Yeah. You'll be so busy, this tank will be used every week. Every Sunday, people will be coming here to be baptized.
Hallelujah.
Can't you believe that? Can't you see that? We don't want to stand before God with a red face. Well, Lord, we failed somehow in Tilton. We failed somehow in Lochmere. We failed in Laconia. We've done this. Oh, Lord. He hears that cry. He says, are you willing to work? Because I'm willing to work with you. Hallelujah. When Pastor Bill comes back here, you try and get another extra 20 or 30 people here to start with. And you'll start a revival in Tilton that'll be noised abroad from Laconia to the White Mountains. Something wonderful is happening in Tilton, New Hampshire.